Good morning. This is Tim Gaylard. I'm at Washington and Lee University, about to give the first lecture on a program about Leonard Bernstein. And this lecture will be an overview of the life and career of that great American. I think one thing that we have to remember about Leonard Bernstein is that we remember him in so many different capacities. He's one of the most talented and multi-functioning American, especially in musical history, because we think of him not just as a conductor, which may be the first way we think of him. We think of him as a composer, but we also think of him as an important music educator. And I do want to touch upon each of those three important positions that he plays in the history of American music. I want us to look at him and just sort of get a sense of his character. He is a man, I think, of great intensity, and we can see that in his face. He's a man of great intelligence. He is somebody who thinks all the time about what he is studying and what he is playing and what he is communicating. He's also a very sensitive man, a man who I think brought that sensitivity to his playing, his conducting, and his educating. There's also that conductor's baton, right, very subtly in the picture to remind us that he was a very important and one of the most important conductors of the 20th century. So in a nutshell, there is Leonard Bernstein. One of the issues I want to play with today is the notion of identity. And who was Leonard Bernstein, and what was he? And the fact that he has these different identities. I'm going to focus on the three that I mentioned, the conductor, the composer, the educator. But I also want us to think about some other identities in passing, and I will mention those along the way. There is, of course, an interesting life story, and we've been using an excellent book by Alan Shawn, which is Leonard Bernstein, an American Musician. A very readable book and a very, I think, fair book. It covers many issues in Bernstein's life, but I think treats them very, very fairly. Also a very intelligent musician who is able to talk about the music of Bernstein and to make it accessible to the reader. So let's talk about the life a little bit. I'm not going to spend my whole time going through all the details of his life, but I do want to give some of the important issues and some of the important dates that come across here. He was, of course, born in 1918. He was born in Lawrence, Massachusetts, which is just outside of Boston. His father, as you see, Sam, ran a barber and beauty supply business and really wanted his son to go into that business. Bernstein was close to his mother, although apparently it was not a happy household growing up. There were issues and there were fights. The two parents were Russian Jewish immigrants, very, very typical of the American story, and we have a young man. We several years ago talked about the great Gershwin, George Gershwin, similar background. I often think that Leonard Bernstein, in a way, takes on the mantle of Gershwin in some degree, but in many other ways, he's not at all like him. There was eventually a family of three children. The second child was Shirley, who was very close to her brother. And maintained a long relationship with him throughout his career. There was a younger brother, Burton, who was born in 1932. He was sort of a much younger child in the family of three. So he's not in this picture. We also have Leonard Bernstein, of course, eventually marrying Felicia, who was a Chilean actress. She was a pianist also, who he had met actually at the home of her piano teacher, the famous Claudio Arrau. And he and Felicia were married in 1951. A very important person in his life and somebody that he loved dearly. Eventually, of course, There were children. There were actually three children eventually, Jamie and Alex and Nina. And you see him already, of course, getting his children to look at music. And this is a publicity photo as well as a part of a Christmas card that was sent out to the Bernstein friends, or season's greetings, I guess, what we would say. There's Bernstein later in life at one of his homes, his sort of getaway home in Fairfield, Connecticut, known as Springgate. And there he is with his three children and a grandchild, and of course, lustily singing at the piano with his children. Again, in this home in Connecticut, which was, of course, just outside New York City, which is where he spent most of his professional career. There is the home, and there's Bernstein. It was a good place for Bernstein to go and work on his composing. So this is him at the at his workplace, working perhaps on a new composition. We need to talk about the Harvard education of Bernstein. He was very, very well educated. He did very well at Harvard. He was a music major. As you see, he received a Bachelor of Arts, cum laude. He was particularly interested in his philosophy courses. I think he could have taught his music professors a few things from what we read, because he already knew so much going into university. We have to remember, too, he was a pianist. His main instrument was the piano. He began lessons at around the age of 10, because the family inherited a piano from an aunt. Not unlike, if you, again, we want to make a comparison with the Gershwins and the piano that came into their family. But we have young Lenny very much being attracted to this instrument, much to his father's fear. His father did not want to see him go into music as a career. Eventually, he was trained by Helen Coates, who remained a very close friend. He went to Curtis after Harvard, and among many other things, he studied piano with the fine Isabel Vengerova. So we do, of course, have to remember that even though we think of him as a conductor, a composer, an educator, that he had this skill at the piano, and a very, very fine skill. Now, the conductor is the first identity that I want to explore in a little more detail. And when we think of a conductor, and I know Scott will be talking about this in the next lecture, you know, the conductor is important as somebody who interprets music and is somebody who brings a tremendous amount of knowledge to the music that he conducts. And this is something Bernstein believed in strongly. We have him, as we read in Sean's book, Bernstein conducting from a very young age and getting his friends and family together, especially his younger siblings, to play roles in various musical projects. And he conducted at camps while he was growing up. We also know that he conducted at Harvard as a student. But of course, his main career as a conductor was really inspired by some very famous conductors in their own right, in particular Dmitri Mitropoulos, who really encouraged Bernstein after he got out of Harvard and Curtis and was wondering what to do with his life. Mitropoulos told him, with your intelligence and with your knowledge, conducting seems to make the most sense in terms of a musical career. There were other important mentors along the way, especially people like Fritz Reiner at Curtis, and in particular Serge Koussevitzky, who was to remain a very important person in Bernstein's life. In fact, Bernstein often thought of Koussevitzky as his musical father, so to speak, because he had the support of Koussevitzky in the way maybe he didn't get from his father until celebrity came and his father realized he'd made the right decision after all. Now, he was eventually hired as an assistant conductor to Arthur Rudzinski at the New York Philharmonic. And it was such a it was an important moment for him in his career because of something that happened. As you know, Carnegie Hall is considered the temple of music, especially in this country. And that was the place where the New York Symphony regularly performed. But as an assistant conductor, Bernstein probably didn't have much hope of ever conducting there unless somebody got ill. Well, somebody did get ill on November the 14th, 1943. The concert was supposed to have been conducted by Bruno Walter at Carnegie Hall. It was going to be actually radio broadcasted across the country. And in the morning of that day, the young Leonard Bernstein was called and said, they told him, "You're on. You're going to conduct the orchestra this afternoon," with no rehearsal. And this, of course, was a challenge which Bernstein lived up to. And you notice there's the program of the important date there, with the name of Bruno Walter crossed out and the typed name of Leonard Bernstein put in there. Now, he was 25 years old. He was relatively young. But because of this concert, it really changed his life. It was the big break that maybe only some musicians can dream about. But this happened to Bernstein in 1943. And notice it was a challenging program. As he describes it, he sort of went into a trance and didn't really remember anything until it was all over. But the audience were incredibly enthusiastic and supportive. And after that, of course, he was in demand all over the world. There he is the following year. He appropriately sent out a card of thanks to the New York Symphony Organization for that opportunity. And this is the following year. He's already starting to look like a celebrity, don't you think? Now, the orchestra which he was most identified with indeed was the New York Philharmonic. And of course, in 1958, he was eventually hired as their principal conductor. Interestingly, the first time an American-born conductor had been in that post, indeed at any post for any classical orchestra in the country. So finally, that glass ceiling was broken with the idea that an American could actually conduct an American orchestra. He was the conductor of the Philharmonic from 1958 until 1969, officially, when then he became, of course, the laureate conductor and continued to conduct that orchestra all the way to the end of his life. So indeed, he was a much beloved conductor by that orchestra. The other orchestra which is very important in his career is the Israel Philharmonic, which he felt very strongly about, I think, because of his Jewish background. He began conducting that orchestra when it was still called the Palestine Symphony in 1947. This is a concert in 1948. Notice that he is at the piano conducting, so he is playing a concerto. I believe he's playing Bert Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. But we have a great amount of support for Bernstein in Israel, and in a way, he felt it important to go back there many, many years. And indeed, he maintained his connection with that orchestra until 1989, so almost to the end of his life once again. Actually, I believe 1990, because the orchestra came to New York and he conducted it in the spring of that year, the last year of his life. Of course, other orchestras that we need to mention, the Vienna Philharmonic, a very, very important orchestra, and one that resisted him for a while, especially in terms of the music of Mahler. He was the one who got them turned around on that. He conducted that orchestra from 1966 to 1990. Now, the other important place, and it's connected to Serge Koussevitzky, is Tanglewood. Has anybody been to Tanglewood? I'm just curious. This is, of course, the summer home of the Boston Symphony Orchestra. It is the place where Serge Koussevitzky took the Boston Symphony and began really a music school for young aspiring musicians. It is still in existence, And it is a place where obviously a lot of us still want to go and hear some great conductors, great performers, great musicians. But also, if you're an aspiring musician, you can go there and study in the summertime. It's a beautiful spot in the western part of Massachusetts, and there are countless concerts throughout the summer. It is, of course, interesting. Bernstein was born on August the 25th, so often he was up there at Tanglewood on his birthday. Some of you who are big fans of Bernstein may not already know this. He had a very important 70th birthday party at Tanglewood in 1988. That is when the song that you heard last night, that wonderful homage to Lenny, written by the words by Stephen Sondheim to the music of Kurt Weill, was sung by Lorraine Bacall, one of his close friends. And that is, of course, the appropriate place where Bernstein celebrated his 70th birthday in 1988. So, the connection with Tanglewood is an extremely important one because it relates to the fact that Bernstein was an educator, right? He wasn't just a conductor and a composer, but he was also interested in young musicians and reaching out to them and inspiring them to conduct or to perform up to their greatest abilities. The other orchestra, of course, that he eventually got to conduct was Herbert von Karajan's orchestra, the Berlin Philharmonic, and perhaps we most associate him with this orchestra with this famous concert on Christmas Day of 1989 when he celebrated the fall of the Berlin Wall by conducting a multinational orchestra in that city. And of course, what work seemed to be the most appropriate but Beethoven's Ninth. And we will come back to that. How many of you saw that on television, by the way? Because it was broadcast internationally, right? It was an extremely important event at the time. Which brings us to the notion of Bernstein and his repertoire as a conductor. And again, I know I'm treading on Scott's territory here, but he, of course, was a conductor who was interested in the traditional repertoire. And he is a very fine conductor of the classical period, Mozart and Haydn in particular. Of course, he is often linked with the works of Beethoven. In a way, perhaps Beethoven was central in his conducting career. Certainly, if we see this with the Beethoven Ninth in 89. Of course, he pursued the literature of the Romantic period quite strongly, music of Tchaikovsky in particular, and of course, the music of Mahler, the great symphonies of Mahler written at the end of the 19th century into the beginning of the 20th century. And in connection with that, of course, Mahler was somebody that he liked to conduct in Israel. And I love this photograph of him as a conductor because he's really putting everything into this climactic moment from one of the most famous works associated with him, which of course is the second symphony of Mahler, nicknamed the Resurrection Symphony. And of course it comes to an incredible climax at the end of the last movement with chorus and full orchestra. So there is Bernstein trying to get the utmost out of his orchestra. And he was theatrical. He was fun to watch, right? Some people found it a little irritating, but it was an exciting way that he conducted and brought us into that experience. Now, as a musician, we have to remember, too, that he continued to play the piano. He often played as a soloist with the orchestras that he conducted. I believe this is a performance in London that he was conducting, and again, playing a work that he often played with orchestras, which was Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. So there are several. If you go on YouTube, you can find Bernstein playing Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue. It is something that he liked to still do, to play piano, to stay in touch with his skills as a pianist from his childhood and all the way through his professional training. Now, there are other orchestras I could have mentioned. I mentioned London. There's the Orchestre de Paris. There's the orchestra in Rome known as the Santa Cecilia Orchestra. He had regular visits with the Boston Symphony, the Pittsburgh Symphony. He was, of course, his home was New York, but keep in mind that he was much in demand around the world, and indeed he took the New York Philharmonic around the world. So he did a tour with them throughout the world. Now, I mentioned the repertoire, the traditional repertoire, but we also have to remember that he conducted a lot of 20th century music, and in particular, he supported his peers, his American composers, who were his friends and who were his colleagues. And so we find in his repertoire many important names in American musical history. And indeed, he really is important, and I'm sure Scott will talk about this, for the revival of the interest in the music of Charles Ives, who was had been largely forgotten about until Bernstein revived an interest in him. But he also, of course, conducted a lot of music by Samuel Barber, Lucas Foss, Aaron Copland in particular, who was, in a way, his mentor. I have my own experience of Bernstein as a conductor. I did see him. I was a grad student at Columbia in the late 70s and the early 80s, and so I had the fortune to see him conduct three times. Once in 1977 with the New York Philharmonic, conducting a Haydn Mass in the first half of the program and a Lucas Foss cantata in the second. So it's typical of him to balance the traditional repertoire with a contemporary piece by one of his composer friends. In 1983, as you might expect, because you know I'm a great opera lover, I attended with my wife the Met Centennial Gala. That was the celebration of the 100th anniversary of the Metropolitan Opera. Well, at the beginning of the second half, and I think it was somewhat unexpected, Leonard Bernstein showed up to conduct one piece. And it wasn't a piece of opera, it was an overture from an opera. It was one of his favorite operas. It was the Leonore Overture No. 3 by Beethoven. So once again, Beethoven, Bernstein. We were sitting in the fourth row of the orchestra. It was thrilling. It was absolutely thrilling just to see Bernstein come out and do that one thing, you know, just make his celebrity appearance at that occasion at the Metropolitan Opera and then disappear. And there were many other conductors that night and, of course, great singers, people like Pavarotti and Franey and so on. But the Bernstein appearance was quite thrilling for the audience as well. 1987, I was determined I had to see this. So I came back, actually, because by now I was at WNL. But in the spring of 87, I got a ticket in New York to see Bernstein conduct the Second Symphony of Mahler, the Resurrection Symphony. And it was one of those experiences that I will never forget, because watching Bernstein and hearing him and seeing his complete commitment to that piece was sort of an overwhelming experience for everyone, I'm sure for the musicians, but especially for the audience. As those of you who may know this piece, the ending of the Mahler Second is like one of the most thrilling moments in all of music. So it was worth going up to New York to see him. And then, of course, sadly, that was the last time I had a chance to see him, because he died in 1990. Now, the reason I was so interested in Bernstein the conductor is that growing up in Canada, I had grown up with many recordings of Bernstein, because he was a prolific conductor of music that was available, especially with the New York Philharmonic on Columbia label. How many of you had Columbia albums of Bernstein conducting something? Well, I had, being a great lover of Mozart, again, a great passion of mine, I bought, you know, I thought, well, I'll be interested to see what Bernstein does with these pieces, the symphonies number 39 and 40 of Mozart, two of the last three great symphonies of Mozart. And the work that I fell in love with, surprisingly, was symphony number 39, probably the least known of those last three symphonies. But it was one of those performances that I just kept wanting to listen to over and over again, especially the second movement, which is at the beginning a very elegant and graceful movement, but then it uncharacteristically for Mozart, sort of lets loose a little bit, and it gets very dramatic. And somehow Bernstein brought that out in the performance that he did with the New York Philharmonic. And I wanted to share that with you right now in the hope that all the technology will work. This is a 1961 recording with the New York Philharmonic. Can you hear it? It's supposed to be soft, but very elegant and graceful here, right? With the Mozart we love. Here it comes. Listen for the change. And then we return to the elegance and the gracefulness of the earlier part of the piece. But here, the music has an ecstatic quality coming up. Listen. Oh, I wish I could go on, but this is not a course in Mozart. He understands the style completely, and yet he brings a tremendous intelligence, a tremendous warmth, and a tremendous emotion into this classical music. When I listened to other recordings of the same piece, it didn't live the way this piece lives with Bernstein. And I think that is something that's important to appreciate in what he brings to the music that he conducts. Again, I'm sure Scott will continue with that discussion. The second piece, a piece of music that we have sort of appropriated because it is American piece of music, it is now such an emotional work. This is the Adagio for Strings by Samuel Barber, that perhaps we notice the soundtrack to two movies I grew up with. Platoon is one, and the other is The Elephant Man. Do any of you know these movies? The soundtrack to those movies is Barber's Adagio for Strings. But it is also now played at tragic events, events that have hit the country really badly. For example, JFK's funeral, it was played. But more recently, after 2001, it was played for the victims of 2001. Well, I've come across, and again, a much beloved performance of this work conducted by Leonard Bernstein with the Los Angeles Philharmonic. The work, if you may remember, is very slow. It's Adagio, after all, and has this sort of undulating theme. Getting more and more intense. We're going to go to the part. And then this wonderful chord change. We don't expect that harmony. And then there's this tremendous moment of silence after this climactic loud chord in the orchestra, and the orchestra comes back in. Remember this? I mean, to me, again, one of the most dramatic moments in all of music, this tremendous outpouring of grief, and then the silence. let's listen to what Bernstein does with that. He takes it at a snail's pace, too. It's one of the slowest performances of this work. So if you're used to other performances, you may find this quite surprising. Now, here's the big moment. And then the chord change. There it is. And he makes them hold on to it forever. Kills me every time. And then we come back to the main theme, of course, here after another silence. Great moment for the cellos. Again, we'd need all 11 minutes to hear the complete performance of that. Some conductors do it in 7, but Bernstein does it in 11 minutes. So you get an idea of how he extends out the intensity and the emotion of that piece. Well, the third example of his conducting, of course, is the most obvious example, the one that, of course, was telecast around the world. And, of course, it, I think, in a way, reflects on much of what Bernstein believed as a human being. Because, of course, the words that are used by Beethoven in his ode to joy, the words of Schiller, are words that are asking all mankind to come together as brothers, right? It is a great hymn to the ideals of the Enlightenment. And Bernstein that day decided he wasn't going to call it the Ode to Joy, but he was going to have them not sing the word Freude in German for joy, but to change the word to Freiheit. I'm looking at Roger over there, and I realize I better watch my German pronunciation, which means freedom. So he actually changed the words of Schiller, as only Bernstein could do, at least for that day, to celebrate the fall of the Berlin Wall. And what he also decided to do was to bring in members of orchestras from around the world, especially the orchestras associated with countries who had occupied Berlin after the war. So there were members of the orchestras in New York, in Paris, in London, as well as Russia, St. Petersburg, which in those days was called Leningrad Philharmonic, and also, of course, members of the German orchestras from both East and West. And then, of course, numerous choristers and choir members from various choirs, as well as a beautiful little children's choir from Germany. And the soloists, the four soloists, included an American, a British, a singer, and two Germans, one East German, one West German. So just a little bit of this. This is the final part of the performance that many of us saw on Christmas Day of 1989. And you'll see the German words go up here at this point. With a huge orchestra and a huge chorus. Okay, again, there's that moment of silence right after the performance. This has been 90 minutes of music. We finally go to, by the way, another very long performance of a work that sometimes isn't done in, 72 minutes, but in this case, took a lot longer. But we have Bernstein, I think, sadly, you know, when you think about this, this is December 25th, 1989. He would be dead a year from that date, right? He died in October of 1990. So this, is, in a way, is his testament to the world with this performance of the Ninth. Now, there are other things, of course, to talk about. We get distracted by Bernstein, the conductor, and of course, it's easy to do so, but we need to get back to our discussion of other identities. Bernstein the educator, and I'm actually not going to talk very much today about that because I've got two more chances to do so. So tomorrow I will be spending more time on Bernstein the educator. But we have to remember he started a series called Omnibus, a TV series that was largely pre-taped and went from 1954 to 1958 using members of the orchestra that had worked with Toscanini, what had originally been known as Symphony of the On the Air. But was, well, that was the new name. There had been the NBC Symphony under Toscanini. But here he starts, this is the first program, and I'm going to show some of this to you tomorrow. Interestingly, starting on November the 14th, 1954. Do you remember that date? November the 14th, 1943 was his debut with the New York Philharmonic, the surprise debut. So he started to have a rather mystical feeling about November the 14th. He actually died, I think, on October the 14th, so he didn't make it that extra month. But we have typically Bernstein reaching out to the general public and educating them with, in this case, a discussion of the most famous piece of classical music, Beethoven's Fifth. So we will probably see more of that tomorrow. Of course, very famously, the Young People's Concerts with the New York Philharmonic, they're now all available on video. And I believe there are, is it 52 of them? The incredible amount of material for us to watch and to learn about music. Of course, there's the idea, which did not originate with Bernstein, but he certainly brought it to a new level, was to bring in the high school, the elementary school children of New York from different parts of the city to come and hear the New York Philharmonic play. And of course, he would stand up and explain the pieces of music before he had the orchestra play them. But he did it unlike anybody else. I've got the number. It's 53 programs that he did from 1958 until 1972. He also returned to his alma mater in 1972. And again, tomorrow I'll be talking about his series of lectures known as The Unanswered Question. That's actually based on a title of a piece of music by Charles Ives. But he returns to the idea of what is music and what are some of the functions of music and where is music going. He's particularly interested in the direction of music, especially in the 20th century. Of course, in 1972, we're still sort of in the middle of the century. So a fascinating series, again, which were all televised and taped, so you can buy the complete set of The Unanswered Question if you want to see this series. And of course, with these series of lectures were often books published of the scripts. If you look in your binder, you will find actually two of those in the binder that I have used. And I grew up with the book Infinite Variety of Music. I put one of my favorite articles from that book in your binder, so you might want to look at that. Again, I'll talk a little bit about that tomorrow. Now, we need to get to Bernstein, the composer, as he, I think he would hope I would do, because in a way, he often was conflicted about what was more important to him, his role as a conductor or his role as a composer. And even there, he has really two identities, because he is both a classical composer as well as a composer of some popular works. If we think of most of the pieces of music we'll be talking about in this particular session, they're Broadway musicals, right, which really belongs more in the popular world than the world of the classical musician. Now, again, we have to remind ourselves, the young composer found a mentor in Aaron Copland, Aaron Copland, born in 1900, as he got his days here, 1900 to 1990. Interestingly, he died just a few weeks after Bernstein, died in December of 1990, but was very much a guide in terms of Bernstein's composing, and often advised him on that. Now, what are the works? Well, there are two operas, Trouble in Tahiti and A Quiet Place, which is in a way a sequel to the first work. Notice the big gap in distance between them. And one that is somewhat autobiographical, people have thought, because of the way the characters develop. Certainly the main characters in Trouble in Tahiti may be based on his own parents, and certainly some of the issues we find in A Quiet Place, which he wrote with the librettist Stephen Wadsworth, have to do with his own life and some of his own struggles. So interesting works, but never really have quite taken up, you know, I don't know what Scott would say about this, but not quite taken on in the opera world the way Bernstein might have hoped. The ballets, Fantasy Free, which led to a more important work, and Facsimile, of course, illustrating what Josh referred to last night with his association with Jerome Robbins and the world of choreography. And of course, the changing nature of dance in America in mid-century, I think, has a lot to do with Jerome Robbins. The symphonies, again, classical works that we don't hear very often. Two works that are, of course, very closely allied with his religious background, his Jewish religion, Jeremiah and the Kaddish symphonies, and works that he felt intensely about and felt they were important works, but again, not very often played by orchestras anymore. The film score, On the Waterfront, you may not have realized that one of Marlon Brando's most famous films was scored by Leonard Bernstein, the only time he wrote a Hollywood score. There's religious music, the Chichester Psalms, which were commissioned by the Three Choirs Festival in England, and he wrote a very interesting set of songs, of psalms, and I'm going to come back to those in a moment. And then, of course, the Mass, the 1971 Mass to celebrate the opening of the Kennedy Center in 1971, and somewhat of a controversial work, but which has, I think, gained in significance over the years and is maybe going to enjoy some sort of renaissance, I hope, because I think it's a much neglected masterpiece of Bernstein's. The Broadway shows, which we will be covering, so I'm not going to talk very much about them right now, but On the Town in 1944, which is a follow-up to Fantasy Free, the ballet, and sort of takes on that. I'm sure Josh will talk more about that. Continued Broadway success with a work we will not be talking about, starring Rosalind Russell, Wonderful Town. Of course, the Candide, the sort of interesting hybrid work. It's hard to classify it. Is it opera? Is it a musical? Well, it's an operetta to some degree, but it is often now performed by opera companies rather than Broadway troupes, maybe more appropriately by opera companies, I'm not sure. But in any case, Scott will be talking about that tomorrow. Of course, his great masterpiece, West Side Story, which of course established him as one of the great innovators in the history of the American musical. And certainly deserves, I think, its position as a landmark work in the history of Broadway. there was a Broadway flop, by the way, in 1976 for the Bicentennial, a work called 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue. And anybody ever seen this work? So it is a work that has fallen into obscurity. Now, there are other identities that I could be talking about. I just should allude to a few of these. The identity, of course, I mentioned his Jewish religion. His grandfather was a rabbi. His father was a very devout with his religion. And we see this in his connection with Israel, going back to Israel to conduct the Israel Philharmonic. In some of his pieces of music, the Kaddish Symphony, the Jeremiah Symphony in particular. The second one is, of course, we think of him as an American. He was an American who really brought the fame of America around the world. He was this multi-talented, he was this outgoing He was this creative, he was this positive human being. He was an inspiring conductor and an inspiring person. I think that sort of helped, you know, the notion of an American abroad, the identity of an American. There is the issue of bisexuality, which actually I think Mr. Shom talks about very fairly, and it's something that Bernstein tried to hide, I think, in the 50s. This was difficult for him. It was something he wasn't sure about, how he was going to deal with these issues in his own sexuality, the struggles that he had, the multiple affairs we find out about, the upheavals that caused in his family. Those are interesting issues that we could talk about if we were doing a psychology course, but I think I will leave that aside for now. The other thing I cannot really avoid mentioning is a connection with Washington and Lee, because one of our most famous alumnus, Tom Wolfe, wrote a very controversial article for New York Magazine in 1970, a very wounding article, which really lampoons Leonard Bernstein and some of his political activities, in particular hosting the Black Panthers at his home in New York. So if you're ever interested, you can find that in Tom Wolfe's complete works. It's a 25,000 word essay. And again, I think Alan Shawn deals with that fairly. And it is a work that I wondered about whether I would put in the binder, and then thought, no, I think 40 pages is more than we need to read. These, by the way, are the apartments that he had at the famous Dakota, the apartment building in New York. Of course, who else lived at the Dakota? Lauren Bacall lived at the Dakota, and I believe John Lennon did as well. So it was an apartment building full of celebrities. And we have to remember, he was a celebrity himself. He was a friend of people like J.D. Rockefeller, an important patron of the arts, and of course Jackie Kennedy, and indeed the Kennedy family was very close. He visited with President Kennedy several times. So of course his politics were Democrat, as you might imagine, and he was very, very much in awe of Kennedy. In fact, the Third Symphony is written in memory of JFK, the Third Symphony of Bernstein. Now, I wanted to end today, I see if we still have a little time, with two pieces of music that perhaps show these two identities as a composer, both the classical and the popular. I'm going to start with the Chichester Psalms. It's one of my favorite pieces. It's a very accessible piece of music written for choir and orchestra. But interesting, if you turn now to your text, you will see that it is also making reference, even though written for, you know, a traditional Church of England gathering of choirs in cathedrals, Bernstein decides to set psalms, and he decides to set those psalms in their original Hebrew. So interesting that he does this. But these are very appealing works. The first movement I wanted to start with, because it gives us some of the character, I think, of the music we associate with Bernstein, the classical composer. And I've listed some of those there. The dissonance that we tend to associate with 20th century classical music, right? This sort of opening statement in the slow section of the first movement. Now, what's interesting about this, yes, it's somewhat dissonant because it's using the interval of the seventh, right? But basically, it's still a tonal piece, still in the key of B flat major. So it's sort of reflecting some of the interesting dualities even within Bernstein's music. That basically, even though he has dissonance in his music, most of his music is fairly tonal. One thing that is very 20th century, and I think he gets this from Stravinsky, the great Russian composer at the beginning of the 20th century, is the rhythmic vitality. And before I play this piece of music, I'm going to ask you to do a little clapping. Because the fast part of this that begins with the words of the second psalm, the psalm number 100, is a piece of music written in the time signature of 7. Now, most Western music is written in either 2, 3, or 4, right? We have 2 beats per measure, 3 beats per measure, or 4 beats per measure. But this piece of music has 7 beats per measure. So it's like having a measure of 4 followed by a measure of 3. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. You want to clap with me? 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3. Listen for that. It goes faster than that, by the way, in the song. But just listen for that. And the wonderfully colorful orchestration. Bernstein has a wonderful sense of color, which again, I think he probably gets from his study of Stravinsky and maybe some of the other French composers at the end of the 19th century. We have also within all of that, this tremendous sense of religious fervor, the connection of Christianity to Judaism, right? This notion that one religion grows out of another. So with that in mind, let's listen to some of this. This is actually a performance conducted by Robert Shaw.
Awake, psaltery and harp. Listen for the change to 7. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four. And just down the down beats. But it's a wonderfully joyous piece, isn't it? And what are the words? Make a joyful noise unto the Lord. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. And the big moment, big exciting moment coming up.
Well, again, wish we had more time, but I think maybe Scott will be talking about these pieces again on Saturday. Yeah, so, and of course, I can't really talk about Bernstein without giving us some of his most famous piece, right? Which is, of course, his West Side Story. Again, I'm treading on the feet of Josh here, but I've chosen the great ensemble tonight, which uses the melody of the love duet we've heard earlier in the show, and then brings it back in a very clever way as a juxtaposed melody against the melodies associated with the two gangs, the Jets and the Sharks. And what I think it shows is Bernstein is bringing his classical sensibility into his popular music. I mean, this is a show on Broadway, remember. It's supposed to have immediate appeal. It's supposed to have all the ingredients that will make it a commercial success. And yet, Bernstein brings to it his musical sophistication. And so we have, of course, this wonderful theme associated with the gangs. Have that, the sort of edgy, dark, somewhat syncopated, and very adolescent, right? It's sort of catching the spirit of adolescence and anger. Then we have this glorious melody, which we all love, right? Tonight. But you start to notice some things interesting. Why? He's really modulating a lot here. What what key is he in, right? We were just trying to figure out. Right, there he is. This is a wonderful chord change, I think. Oh, there we are. Right, there's the key that we wanted. But there's all this wonderful harmonic sophistication, which reminds me, by the way, of Gershwin, right? I think there is a sort of a chord sense here that reeks of Gershwin, maybe also of Bernstein's great interest in the music of jazz and the wonderful chord changes you have in that music, and the idea that jazz can influence his musical style. So, with that in mind, let's listen to this wonderful moment from A West Side Story. I think it's the best way to close out a discussion of Bernstein.
And you have the complete text, by the way, after the Chichester songs. By the way, this is called polyphonic texture, right? When you put two different melodies together at the same time. It's not happening yet, but it's going to be set up in that way. Wonderful words of Stephen Sondheim.
We're gonna rock it tonight. We're gonna jazz it up and have us a ball. They're gonna get it tonight. The more they turn it up, the harder they fall. Well, baby, get it. Well, baby, get it. And play it once and slap it once and for all.
By the way, this is the original Broadway cast recording. You'll hear a different version this afternoon. This is the melody we all know and love, right? Okay, for the sake of time, I'm going to move it forward just a little bit. Now, this is where it gets very clever because we start to hear several melodies going together at the same time.
True polyphony now. Well, we have to remember it was a rich life. It was a life full of creativity, of great music making, of inspiring musical moments, both for audiences and for performers who worked with him. And this is just scratching the surface. So I look forward to exploring with my colleagues more about Bernstein in the next few days. Thank you very much. question.
So he had his big break as a conductor when
yes.
he was 25 yeah. during the midst of World War II. How did he avoid
that? He had asthma, apparently. That was his medical condition. So apparently he could not sign up for the Army. That is what we read anyway. That's what my understanding of. Yeah. Anything else? Yes?
Well, it's a question that has to be raised
yes.
for people such as I who don't know a whole lot about music.
Okay.
And I want to know more about the role of the conductor. I mean, you base so much of your admiration for Bernstein uh-huh. is in his conducting. Mm-hmm. He is what? The principal interpreter of the original piece of music.
Yes.
And somehow he has to persuade the disparate members of the orchestra to come together in agreement.
Right.
And yet he is the central place to hear the music.
Yes.
As well as to feel as he would hope that it was originally intended to be felt.
Well,
can you elaborate?
Well, he can elaborate on it, and maybe Scott will elaborate on it. But the wonderful thing about that is that Bernstein talks about that very issue in many of his lectures. So I would recommend, if you have not seen, I believe it's the second one in the Omnibus series, where he talks about what is it like to be a conductor, and what do I have to do, and what do I have to know, and how do I go about getting what I want. These are challenges that he thought about a great deal, and he took very, very seriously. He said a conductor will sense immediately if you don't know your stuff, you know, when you get up in front of them, because they're musicians. They've played under all the great conductors, especially these orchestras that he was in charge of. And he had a rough time, by the way, with the Vienna Philharmonic. I mean, you know, there were many issues there. He was an American, he was a Jew, and he was trying to convince them that Mahler was a great composer, and they hadn't played him in 50 years, you know, just. It's something that really you have to admire about him, that he got that orchestra to love Mahler and to play it really amazingly well. And he said to them, this is your tradition. This is Vienna. Mahler conducted your ancestors playing in this orchestra. You must love this music. And eventually they did, but it took a while. And that's the magic of Bernstein. He is able to do that, but he does in his videos often explain what he does. I just watched, I mean, there's so many to watch, but I watched a wonderful one he did of him conducting Bach. And you don't think of him as a Bach conductor, but he knew Bach and he knew what he had to do to get a performance. It's of the Magnificat, which is actually one of my favorite pieces. But Bernstein's thinking immediately about all the elements of Bach. He talks about Bach in another lecture to children about polyphony and counterpoint and fugue and all, and you think, how can he be doing this? But he does it so well that he brings you in and starts you to appreciate the composer behind the music. And I think that's the magic of Bernstein, is that in a way the identity worked for him. Whether he was a composer or a conductor, it didn't matter, because he was thinking like a composer when he was conducting. And I think that made it easier for him. Yes. Ma'am, yes, yeah.
Sorry. What language did he actually use when he was dealing with the Vienna Philharmonic and with the Paris Orchestra?
Well, he was multilingual. You'll see that if you go see the movie tonight, The Gift of Music. It's a wonderful, you see him speaking in German. His German was very good. He did speak some French, obviously, and he also spoke some Russian. And keep in mind of his heritage, right? Russian-Jewish, so he was very adept at languages, but you do see him working with orchestras in their language. He doesn't always use English. Yes?
You said he had a big breakthrough in when he was a substitute, he learned that day, and he had no rehearsal. How did he?
Well, he knew the music, and he was supposed to be, you know, like an understudy in a Broadway show. You have to know the part, even though you may never get to play the role. The same thing with an assistant conductor for the New York Philharmonic. You've got to know that music they're playing. You may have rehearsed with them a little bit in earlier sessions, but, you know, obviously going out cold on the day of the performance with no warming up and no sort of I mean, it's amazing that he was able to succeed and actually communicate what he wanted them to do. And there is a quote, if you look later, because I'll be talking about this on Saturday, one of the members of the orchestra sort of said to himself before Bernstein came out, oh, this is going to be a disaster, and you know, and then when he started, apparently, and he wasn't conducting it all the way Bruno Walter would have conducted it, so that's the other thing, that it was just so amazing that he was able to communicate what he wanted with actually very little rehearsal time.
Yeah, Bruno Walter was one of those conductors who...
Exactly, not nearly as dynamic as Bernstein, so a very different conducting style. Well, we have to go and get a picture taken, so I think we've got to say goodbye.
Thank you.